I'm super excited to take a look at this today. It's a paper written by Alan Turing in 1950, and it's called Computing Machinery and Intelligence. In it, Alan Turing talks about the imitation game for the first time, which has come to be known as the Turing Test. It's a famous idea in computer science, and you'll hear it mentioned often, but until now, I had never actually read the original paper where it was explained by Alan Turing himself, and I'm glad that I finally did. I think anyone interested in artificial intelligence would benefit from reading the original paper, so let's take a look at it. Turing starts off by considering the question, can machines think? But figures that actually that question is way too ambiguous. The words machine and think are too ambiguous to define, and instead he comes up with a game, the imitation game, which he thinks will be equivalent to asking if machines can think. The next paragraph surprised me. It's the first mention of what this imitation game is, but there's no robots involved yet. It is an interrogator trying to tell the difference between a man and a woman. I don't think that's the kind of game you would see included in a scientific paper these days. He says the game is played with three people. A is a man, B a woman, and C is the interrogator. The interrogator stays in a room apart from the other two. The object of the game, for the interrogator, is to determine which of the other two is the man and which is the woman. In order to tell this difference, the interrogator could apparently ask questions such as, will X, referring to one of the unknown participants, please tell me the length of his or her hair? This communication would ideally be written so that the tones of voice don't give anything away. The man is working to deceive the interrogator by imitating a woman, whereas the real woman is working to help the interrogator make the right identification. Now, here is the important part where the game evolves. We now ask the question, what will happen when a machine takes the part of participant A, the man, in this game? Will the interrogator decide wrongly as often when the game is played like this, as he does when the game is played between a man and a woman? These questions replace our original, can machines think? There are two ways that this can be interpreted. One is the literal interpretation, where the man is replaced by a machine, but nothing else about the game changes, meaning that the machine has now taken over the man's role of pretending to be a woman. In this version of the game, we have a man trying to convince an interrogator that he is a woman, competing against a machine that is doing the same, and trying to see which one can imitate a woman better. This is a bit of an odd question and throws the game into the complicated world of gender identity and expression, but it is the most literal interpretation of Turing's words. The benefit of interpreting the game like this is that it disguises the participation of the machine. The interrogator just thinks they are trying to tell the difference between a man and a woman, and they don't know that machines are involved at all, so they are less biased and less on the lookout for questions that would trip up a machine. But this isn't the standard interpretation of Turing's words. The more popular understanding is that when Turing says that participant A is replaced by a machine, it is assumed that the goal of the game also changes. It's no longer about pretending to be a woman, but is about pretending to be a human, full stop. The interrogator is no longer picking between male and female for the participants. Instead, they are choosing between machine and human. This interpretation seems to be more in line with comments that Turing later makes about ways to compare humans and machines. Things go totally off the rails in this next section, where Turing is trying to define the requirements to enter a machine into the game. He seems to be a little bit worried that a team of engineers will say they've made a machine, but actually just enter a human that they made into the competition. And so I just have to read you this next part. He says, one might, for instance, insist that the team of engineers should be of all one sex. This would not really be satisfactory, for it is probably possible to rear a complete individual from a single cell of the skin, say of a man. To do so would be a feat of biological technique deserving of the highest praise, but we would not be inclined to regard it as the case of constructing a thinking machine. This prompts us to abandon the requirement that every kind of technique should be permitted. So you're allowed to enter a machine that you make, but you can't clone yourself or make a baby and enter that. He settles on saying that only digital computers will be allowed to take part in our game. He says there are already a number of digital computers in working order. The digital computers in 1950 still looked nothing like the digital computers that we know today, but he says he's not asking whether the computers available at present would do well, but whether there are imaginable computers which would do well. And now we get to the real juicy part of this paper. Alan Turing first shares his own opinion on the matter. He says that he believes that in about 50 years' time, which would be about the year 2000, it would be possible to program computers to play the imitation game so well that an average interrogator would not have a more than 70% chance of making the correct identification after 5 minutes of questioning. He believes that the original question, "Can machines think?" is too meaningless to deserve discussion, but that by the end of the century, one will be able to speak of machines thinking without expecting to be contradicted. Large language models that we have now, like ChatGPT, might be the kind of thing that Alan Turing was trying to imagine would succeed at his imitation game. And I think he did a pretty good job of estimating what it would be able to do. But his second point, that by around the year 2000, people would consider machines thinking, I don't think has come true yet. ChatGPT might do well at the imitation game, but I don't agree with Turing's point that that would mean that humans would then consider it thinking. In fact, what we've really seen is that we continuously move the goalposts for what we consider a thinking machine to be able to do. I don't think that for us now, being able to mimic human speech in an interrogation would be enough. My guess is that we don't ever want to consider machines thinking. And so as they approach any arbitrary test that we put before them, we'll come up with a new one that is more difficult and that we consider to be more human. Turing doesn't really have a lot of evidence that he can present to back up his claim that he thinks a machine will be able to do well at his imitation game. So instead, he tries to imagine every possible point someone could have to try and say that machines will never think, or that machines will never do well at this game. To do this, Turing has to put himself in the shoes of people who don't believe in his work in the same way that he does. And it's pretty impressive that he's able to do this. He comes up with 9 objections. The first one is, okay, maybe you can make an impressive machine, but it will never be able to think, because thinking is a function of a human's immortal soul. Turing is not so impressed with this argument and basically says that if God is almighty, he can give a soul to whoever or whatever he wants to. He could give a soul to an elephant, or he could give a soul to a machine. Okay, but what if this is all too dreadful to think about and we don't want to know about it? That's the heads in the sand objection. In a kind of cold response to this, Turing says, I do not think that this argument is sufficiently substantial to require refutation. Consolation would be more appropriate. Okay, but what about the fundamental limitations of mathematics? In our current understanding of mathematics, there are logical statements that can lead to contradictions or paradoxes. Given that a digital computer will never be able to do everything, that there will be some questions to which it will either give a wrong answer or fail to give an answer at all. Since machines are built upon logical systems, they have a disability to which the human intellect is not subject. Turing says that the superiority we feel in this area is actually just an illusion, that we too give wrong answers based upon our own flawed logical systems. A pretty strong objection is the argument from consciousness. Now, he has to be pretty clever to come up with counterpoints to this objection, because it's claiming that, yeah, okay, a machine might be able to write a sonnet, for example, but until you can prove that it actually has understood what it's written, well, then that doesn't count as thinking. To satisfy someone who thinks in this way, you would need to prove that the machine actually did have some kind of deep understanding of what it was able to produce. This is a problem for humans too. This is why if you write a thesis, you might be asked to do a viva or an oral exam, where a professor will ask you questions about your work, and you have to defend why you made the decisions that you did, and prove by answering questions that you understand your work. Turing writes up one such exam for a machine, and to be honest, this looks really similar to the kind of dialogue and defense I was able to get out of ChatGPT when I asked it why it made certain word choices in a poem that it had generated. Just like Alan Turing predicted, machines can already do a pretty convincing job of defending their work. But this still doesn't necessarily mean that they can think and that they truly understand it. Philosophically, we face a conundrum that none of us have any evidence that anyone other than ourselves is thinking. But for the sake of our own individual sanity, we have to assume that other people in the world can think without us being able to enter their mind and prove it. Any questions or debate around consciousness are pretty difficult because there is still a lot of mystery to it. But having done a pretty decent job at giving some counter-arguments here, Turing has the confidence to go on and then counteract another difficult objection. This one says that, sure, you can make a clever machine, but you will never be able to make it do X. I think my favorite part of this whole paper is the ideas that Turing gives for what X could be. He considers that you might never be able to make a machine that can be kind, resourceful, beautiful, friendly, have initiative, have a sense of humor, tell right from wrong, make mistakes, fall in love, enjoy strawberries and cream, make someone fall in love with it, learn from experience, use words properly, be subject of its own thought, have as much diversity of behavior as a human, or to do something really new. This is my favorite part of the paper because considering each of these things in turn and wondering if a machine could ever be able to do them is something that I find really fun and interesting to think about. Turing says it's perfectly reasonable to expect machines to be able to make mistakes, that even a process of scientific induction can lead to erroneous results. And thinking about the claim that a machine could not be subject of its own thought, Turing says that by observing the results of its own behavior, it could modify its own programs so as to achieve some purpose more effectively. He says these are possibilities of the near future rather than utopian dreams. Number 6 is Lady Lovelace's objection. Ada Lovelace lived long before Alan Turing, so the part of her that is represented in this section is not literally her responding and objecting to Turing, rather it is Turing including something that she had written in her time back when she was working on the analytical engine with Charles Babbage, an awesome, giant, steam-powered mechanical computer. She said of the analytical engine that it has no pretensions to originate anything, that it can do whatever we know how to order it to perform. A way to interpret this could be to say that a machine could never do anything really new, or never take us by surprise. But perhaps it is very understandable that when Ada Lovelace wrote this statement, she didn't have much reason to believe that this would ever be possible. Her and Babbage were under no obligation to claim all that could be claimed. We could challenge this idea by considering that there is nothing new under the sun. Who can be certain that original work that he has done was not simply the growth of the seed planted in him by teaching, or the effect of following well-known general principles? Turing also notes that machines take him by surprise with great frequency. Argument 7 explores the idea that you could consider our brain and nervous system to be continuous, whereas a machine would be discrete, and asks, can a discrete state machine built on just math ever mimic a brain with complex neurons? Turing thinks it can come pretty close to doing so. Argument 8 says that thinking will look pretty different for a human and a machine because our behavior is not based on a rigid set of rules. We think that machines are governed by laws and we are not. Therefore, we are better than machines. We might not have rigid rules of conduct or behavior, but we do have the laws of physics, and our bodies are bound by those. In that way, you could consider our bodies a kind of machine, and we also can't guarantee ourselves that we don't follow some complete laws of behavior, because in the spirit of science, we'll never reach a point where we could say that we've searched enough and there are no laws. Number 9, I'd never heard anyone mention until I read it here in the paper, and it's given plenty of space here, so I'm not sure if that means Alan Turing thought a lot about it and took it seriously, or what was going on. But number 9 is the argument from extrasensory perception. It includes a line saying that, unfortunately, the statistical evidence, at least for telepathy, is overwhelming. I don't know exactly what he's referring to with that, but he does seem to consider that his imitation game does need to take telepathy into account. He even says this argument is, to my mind, quite a strong one. He suggests that to overcome this, you could do something like putting the competitors into a telepathy-proof room. So now that Turing has finished convincing everyone that machines should be able to do well at this imitation game, the next big question is how to make such a machine. This section here is Turing at his visionary best. It's him imagining a way to build a machine and teach a machine all it knows to be good at imitating a human. This part is interesting. He says that to best imitate an adult human mind, you should consider 3 things. One is the initial state of the mind, say at birth. The second is the education to which it has been subjected. And the third is other experience, not to be described as education, to which it has been subjected. So then he goes on to talk about these 3 stages and how to replicate them in a machine. He says it would be easier to build a child's mind and then teach it all that it needs to know, rather than trying to build and start with a knowledgeable adult mind. We can see parallels here to what might be the first ideas or mentioning of machine learning. Turing mentions wanting to use punishments and rewards as a learning process, but that you'd have to ensure that these are unemotional, otherwise the machine would get pretty demotivated if you're telling it no all the time. There's an interesting point here that the machine you're building should include a random element in its learning. The random element might help it to have a process that's more analogous to evolution and the random power of mutations. And randomness is a key element of modern machine learning. Turing says that we may hope that machines will eventually compete with humans in all purely intellectual fields. And I love this last line. He says, "We can only see a short distance ahead, but we can see plenty there that needs to be done." So much of what Turing is imagining, we've been lucky to already witness. And despite that, many of us are no closer to regarding machines as thinking entities. I wonder if the human spirit can ever be put into a test, and what kind of test would satisfy us that a machine had taken its first steps onto the continuum of intelligence. Let me know in the comments what ideas you have for a variant of this test or something else that would make you really stop and reconsider what machines mean to you. Would you ever feel empathy for one? And would you ever consider it to think? Thanks for watching this video, and thank you to my Patreon supporters for making it possible. A special shout out to today's Patreon Cat of the Day, Dixie.